Judea Black, Shalom L'Chaim, purified drink of water. They got it. It's up there. Shouts out to the 12 tribe, man. Support the people, not the cause. Yes, this next video was to Seti, and then carrying on from there, man. Judea Black, Shalom L'Chaim, purified drink of water. They got it. It's up there. Cue that music I like.
Oh, it doesn't seem right. I was born white, and my parents don't fight. They just told me they love me even nights. I don't lose sleep for the kids sewing my sheets. Oh, the one stitching my sneaks. As long as I can buy them both cheap.
Ancient Egypt is oftentimes regarded as Africa's oldest great civilization. But what if I was to tell you that that isn't actually the case? What if I told you that an even older ancient African civilization, just as great as Kemet, existed? Yeah, really. Although just as great and ancient as Kemet, this civilization is often overlooked by mainstream scholars and the general media. And if this civilization is mentioned at all, it doesn't often get the respect it deserves. Why is that, you may ask? Well, that's because unlike its sister civilization to the north of the Nile Valley, this civilization does not have a race controversy. All the scholars agree they were Black Africans. And as we should know too well by now, is that great Black African achievements tend to get overlooked or swept under the rug by you know who. I won't say any names here. And that's why we're here, to rectify that. So without further ado, let me introduce you to ancient Egypt's older sister, Nubia, also known as Taseti, the land of the bow. So Taseti, what's the history? What do the scholars know about it? Is it really older than Kemet? What does Nubia or Taseti refer to? Taseti refers to a group of ancient African civilizations that emerged and flourished in the southern part of the Nile Valley some very, very long time ago. This civilization is also known as Nubia, Kerma, Meroe, or Kush, depending on the period we are talking about. But one thing worth noting is that Nubia usually refers to the area located in northern Sudan, whereas Kerma, Kush, or Meroe would be referring to a specific period in the history of the civilization of the area known as Nubia. Nubia is also the civilization from which came the originators of dynastic Kemet. The originators of dynastic Kemet came from Nubia. Yes, now, is Nubia really older than ancient Egypt? Yes, it is. According to the work of Dr. Bruce Williams and other archaeologists, Nubia seems to predate Pharaonic Egypt by at least 800 to 1000 years. This is evidenced by findings such as the Kustul incense burner and other elaborate ceramic pots that were dated to 3800 BC, a very long time ago, when you contrast that with dynastic Egypt, which is believed to have begun around 3300 to 3100. Nubian civilization, in contrast, is believed to have begun around 5000 to 4000 BC. And they believe this because one does not develop such elaborate pieces of art as this incense burner within 2 centuries. Such art takes a long time to develop. It takes a long time to reach such fine elaboration, if you get what I mean. That's why although the ceramic pots are dated to 3800 BC, they push back the date of the creation of the civilization to at least 4500 BC to 5000 BC. Therefore, while Kemet was still in its infancy during its pre-dynastic period, Taseti was already a big girl with powerful rulers and a major civilization of its time. This was already mentioned in the previous video among the characteristics of the Nakhtawan culture, which stated that Nakhtawan is characterized by trade with important civilizations of its time, such as Mesopotamian civilizations and Nubia. So by the scholars' own admission there, Taseti was already an important civilization when Kemet was still in its infancy. Yet this is hardly openly admitted or mentioned. See for instance this Wikipedia article on Nubia. It gives people the impression that Nubian civilization is only from 3500 BC, while we know that it was already a major civilization by Nakhtawan, which is from 3900 BC. See the crookery there? However, when you click on the link of the Agro period of Nubian civilization, you quickly learn that the date is actually around 3800 BC instead of 3500 BC. The crookery does not stop there, however. Take a look at what the University of Chicago says about the coastal burner that they excavated in Nubia. This incense burner is distinctively Nubian in form. Carved in the technique of Nubian rock art, it is decorated on the rim with typical Nubian designs. It is found in the tomb of a Nubian ruler at Kustul and incorporates images associated with Egyptian pharaohs, a procession of sacred boats, the white crown of Upper Egypt, a falcon deity, and the palace facade called a serek. It appears to represent a ritual that involved a royal procession by boat to a palace. Now let's see how they explain all that Egyptian pharaonic imagery. How did Nubia relate to Egypt during the A group? The scenes depicted on the Kustul incense burner have excited considerable interest and discussion. Why would seemingly Egyptian symbols have been used in Nubia? One interpretation is that Nubian A group rulers and early Egyptian pharaohs used related royal symbols. Similarities in rock art of A group Nubia and Upper Egypt support this position. Another view suggests that the decoration was carved by Nubians in imitation of Egyptian art and rituals. In this perspective, A-group Nubian rulers would have emulated the symbols of Egyptian pharaohs, whose prestige and power were evident. So the first interpretation there of the reason why pharaonic tradition is found in Nubia states that it's because the Nubians and the Egyptians were using the same symbols of power, since they are from the same region, which makes sense, right? Now the question is, who copied who? So to the University of Chicago, they claim that they believe the Kustul burner was copied from Egyptians. Now that right there is just some intellectual dishonesty. Whatever important thing is found in Nubia, scholars always try to attribute it to ancient Egypt, some way, somehow. And that is just some BS behavior. The Kustul burner was found in Nubia, not in Egypt. That's one fact. It contains typical Nubian rock art. They claimed it themselves, right? According to the scholars themselves. Yet they still want to attribute it to Kemet. What's their reasoning? Well, there are some pharaonic symbols on it. So yeah, that must mean the Nubians copied the Egyptians. This is always their assumption. They can't assume otherwise. Even if another obvious explanation is that pharaonic tradition was already in use in Nubia before it ever was in Kemet. Since at the time the incense burner was made, Egypt was barely beginning the monarchy thing, while Nubia was already a major civilization with a monarchy for at least 500 years. So why not attribute those symbols to them, since they found the incense burner there in the first place, and they even believe that it was made by Nubians? Why not? The decorations around the Kustul burner are typical Nubian decorations, they stated it. But no, to them, it's gotta be the Egyptians. Just because I got this fairy tale in my mind telling me that nothing of consequence can come out of Nubia.
This is an absurdity.
Pathetic. The evidence is there to support a Nubian origin of the pharaonic symbols. Let's do a little thought experiment here. Just imagine if they had found this incense burner in Sumer or Mesopotamia. They would have decreed, without the shadow of a doubt, that pharaonic tradition started in Mesopotamia or in Sumer. End of the story. But since it's in Africa, in Nubia there, they start doubting the origin and prefer instead to make up a bedtime story about how Egyptians invented something that their neighbors were practicing before them. They even state that they have evidence of earlier pharaonic tradition at Abydos. But I checked it out, and their so-called evidence is nothing more than a few paintings of some Egyptian lord. They don't see the crown there. We don't see the crown. We don't see the white crown of Upper Egypt. The wall paintings, as I read the article, which I'm not gonna post here, I'm just gonna link it in the description if you wanna check it out. The wall painting does not contain the pharaonic symbols that came from Upper Egypt. I checked the oldest pharaonic symbols with the white crown at Abydos, and they were dated to 3000 BC, not 3400 BC, while the Kustul incense burner is dated at 3200 BC. In any case, the man who founded the custodian St. Bernard himself, that is, Professor Bruce Williams of the University of Chicago, believes that the Nubians were using pharaonic symbols before the Egyptians ever did. To him, it's quite simple. The Egyptians merely copied and incorporated what their predecessors from Nubia were already doing. This makes sense since the pre-dynastic Egyptians themselves came from Lower Nubia. Also, as I mentioned in the previous video, the Egyptians believed that their god, who was also a Nubian god, first passed by Nubia, then went on to Egypt. This could be interpreted as Egypt taking its spirituality from Nubia and the further land of Punt, which is located further inside the continent of Africa. And this makes sense since Nubia is a clear bridge between the interior of the continent and Egypt.
Very audacious, Mr. Garrett.
I think of it in purely logical terms.
And this is not just my opinion. Diodorus Siculus seemed to agree with the Nubians when they told him that Egypt was a colony of Ethiopia. Here is the quote. Now the Ethiopians, as historians relate, were the first of all men, and the proofs of this statement, they say, are manifest. For that they did not come into their land as immigrants from abroad, but were natives of it, and so justify bear the name of autochthones is, they maintain, conceded by practically all men. So, as you can see here, Diodorus Siculus seems to tell us that Egypt is a colony of Ethiopia. They came from Ethiopia. Ethiopia here refers to Nubia. And also, he states that all historians at the time, all ancient men, seemed to believe that Ethiopia was the first country of this world. And when you read the full quote, you also realize that ancient men believed that Africa was the cradle of humanity, which has been confirmed by modern science. Let's continue reading. Diodorus Siculus continues. They say also that the Egyptians are colonists sent out by Ethiopians, Osiris having been the leader of the colony, and the larger part of the customs of the Egyptians are, they hold, Ethiopian, the colonists still preserving their ancient manners. For instance, the belief that their kings are gods, the very special attention which they pay to their burials, and many other matters of a similar nature are Ethiopian practices. So here you can see that Diodorus Siculus does not seem to question all those practices because he saw them both in Ethiopia and Egypt. Now here are some other quotes of some scholars who agree with this position. Joseph Vogel wrote that the period when sub-Saharan Africa was most influential in Egypt was a time when neither Egypt, as we understand it culturally, nor the Sahara, as we understand it geographically, existed. Populations and cultures now found south of the desert roamed far to the north. The culture of Upper Egypt, which became dynastic Egyptian civilization, could fairly be called a Sudanese transplant. So, as you can see here, this scholar seems to agree that Upper Egyptians who later on civilized Egypt were Nubians. As Diodorus Siculus said, they were just Ethiopian colonists. Another scholar is British Africanist Basil Davidson, who outlined that the ancient Egyptians belonged, that is, not to any specific Egyptian region or Near Eastern heritage, but to that wide community of peoples who lived between the Red Sea and the Atlantic Ocean, shared a common Saharan Sudanese culture, and drew their reinforcements from the same great source, even though as time went by, they also absorbed a number of wanderers from the Near East.
Ancient Nubia and ancient Egypt share roots, common cultural roots in Northeast Africa, in the Sahara, and along the Nile Valley. The ancient Egyptians and the ancient Nubians can both be described, especially in the earlier periods, as being descendants of Northeast African indigenous populations. As one writer said, all of these people are Africans, and I define Africans as people whose biological histories have emerged, and their identities have emerged in Africa, and where any mixing that took place on African soil.
Okay, now I'll give a brief outline of the history of Nubia, then we'll move on to the peopling. Nubia's history stretches back thousands of years before the existence of Christ. It's a very long time ago. According to the General History of Africa, Volume 2, Nubia has a long history, which is dated from about 7000 BC to 700 CE. That's after Christ was born. That's a very, very long time. Holy cow. Almost 8000 years of history. Anyways, this very long period of time is divided into several parts. These periods are the prehistoric period, from 7000 BC to 4000 BC. By this point, Nubia was already farming and producing pottery. During this period, Nubia is also known to have built the world's first astronomical site known as Naptopia. Yes, they did. You can Google it. It seems just like humanity, astronomy too was born in Africa. After the prehistoric period, we have the A group Nubians, who lasted from 4000 BC to 3000 BC. By this time, there were already a full-on civilization with big towns and rulers and such. These Nubians were also very influential to Upper Egyptians, who later on unified Kemet. Then we have early Kerma, from 3000 BC to 2400 BC. So it seems there had been a shift there because the Egyptians, who had then become a dynastic empire, they decided to crush the very people who influenced them, who were so very influential to them. It's so tragic. How can you beat your older sister, Egypt? Naughty child of Africa. What a naughty girl. Then comes the C group Nubians, who lasted from 2400 BC to 1500 BC.
1550 BC. Little precision there.
Then comes the Kerma culture. By this time, Egypt had taken over as the main powerful civilization of the Nile Valley, but the Kerma culture came to show them that Nubia was not done yet. So during this period, powerful rulers arose and conquered more land, constructed beautiful cities and buildings. Then from 700 BC to 500 BC,
542 BC. Little precision there, Quedemica.
I know. 542 BC, thank you. Okay, in 500 BC comes the Napatan period, also known as Kush, when powerful kings such as Taharqa ruled and freed their brothers in Kemet from the horrific rule of Asiatic foreigners during the 25th dynasty of Kemet. Home Team History did a video on this period. You should check out his channel, I love the content there. Then comes Meroe, from 542 BC to 400 CE. Long time right there. How about a millennium? This is when the capital of the kingdom of Kush was shifted from Napata to Meroe. This period is also quite impressive, with beautiful architecture and script invention such as the Meroitic script, and other powerful rulers such as the queen or Kandake Amanorenes. That was a queen. She defeated the Roman army and stopped further Roman expansion into Africa.